Good Sunday morning, everyone. Last Sunday, I found these glasses, which, although they look stylish on me, they're not mine. Did anybody forget a set here? They're right up here. I'm assuming they got taken off during the photos. No? Oh, Brenda has her hand up.
It's fine.
Oh, no, this is good. I don't mind walking. So, hey, we got a few announcements today. A bunch of different things going on. In case you don't know already, we are having a water slide here this afternoon from 1 to 5. In fact, Rhonda's back there now supervising the delivery. So that's awesome. We also have a baptism at 6 p.m., and that is going to be at Urban and Charlie Renewed Pool. And Urban said that, let's see if I recall the directions properly. At their house, if you run out of parking on the front area, you can just pull around the side in the back, right? And there's parking in the back as well. And it is Caden and Drake being baptized today at 6 p.m. So. All right. There is a charity dinner. Let's see. For Susan Myers. I don't know if anyone knows her. Her husband was the pastor at Salem Wesley for a long time and part of the East Jackson County Ministerial Association. But she has pancreatic cancer, and Delwood Baptist Church is hosting a charity dinner, $12 a plate, and they'll have gospel music, and I think they're doing pulled pork for the meal. But it is Saturday, August 19th, and what time? I don't see a time on the flyer. Oh, there it is, 6 p.m. I just got to get better glasses. Maybe I need those glasses back, Brenda. But 6 p.m. Saturday, August 19th, for whoever wants to go and help them raise some money for the cancer treatments. All right. Let's see, other announcements. We have some anniversaries. August 2nd, Richie and Becky, their anniversary. And then August 3rd, Ricky and Debbie Davis. So make sure if you see them around town this week, you wish them a happy anniversary, all right? Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries this week? I see fingers being pointed.
There's a woman on top here. And I can't say nothing about it
because
she don't like to be noticed. But
Cindy Abel. Would that be like Cindy Abel?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So, and that's a birthday this week?
Yes.
On the 2nd?
Correct.
See, I used to play that game of charades. Okay. Becky's back there giving me hand signals, so. Are there other birthdays or anniversaries? No? All right. That is awesome. Hey, I already talked about the water slide and the baptism. August 5th, Grand Ridge Middle School is having a community work day to get the school cleaned up and ready. And I believe, Becky, if I'm wrong, you said 7 a.m. is the start time?
Yes.
All right. And all hands are welcome, right? Yes. All right. Hey, you may have seen this out there on Facebook. We need you. It's that time of the year again when we start looking at filling out our committees for those that are rolling off. And we need some people for finance, admin council, trustees, pastor parish relations, and I forget one, I think.
No,
that's it. Okay. Yep. Thank you. But if you like to organize, if you have a heart to serve, good with your hands, good with numbers, good with administrative tasks, or just have some darn good ideas, we would love for you guys to let us know so the nominations committee can try to figure out where the holes are and plug people in. All right? So let us know, please. Let's see, make sure I got... Oh, okay, one more announcement. If you'll notice out this doorway, The wood around the post has been removed. We have a general contractor coming to take a look at it. Some of the men noticed that there was a slight lean to the post area there, and they just want to make sure everything's fine. It was probably left over from Hurricane Michael. So they're just going to come and take a look at it and see where, if we have to have any major concerns or if we're okay. But they are coming Tuesday. One group at 10 and another one at noon. All right. Any other announcements? I see a hand back there.
I know you mentioned the slide, but please make sure you bring the kids a towel this afternoon. And also, there'll be a snow cone machine, and so they'll get snow cones. And it's in the bulletin that Monday night is UMW, but it's actually Tuesday night.
Tuesday.
Sorry for the inconvenience of that. It's Tuesday night.
Are they both nights?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm
Monday. All right. Any others? No? All right. Let's as we move into our time of. Oh, okay. Becky?
I know I asked you guys last week to pray for one of our employees that was diagnosed with breast cancer. I've also got another employee who contacted me yesterday. It's her grandmother. She actually calls her mom. She's been raised by her. Gloria Presley. She's been placed on hospice and has been given just a few short weeks. So if you can please put her and her family as well in your prayers. She's a sneeze local.
All right. Any others? Up front, Adam, you got it. There you go. Right there, John, you got it.
I know I said last week, but Claudette is built this close to get her shoulder rebuilt. She's got to go down to Panama City Wednesday to see what all we all need, and then what she tired
of
it hurt, she wants to get it done.
All right.
Last one, sorry. I know that many of our local schools, we're all still looking for employees, so if you can just put a prayer in for that. I know I need one teacher, Sunny's Elementary, I think is still looking for five. So if you know anybody with warm bodies with bachelor's degrees or anybody seeking employment, please send them our way.
All righty. Any others? Emily is not well, okay. All right, then. Why don't we go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, you have blessed us in many ways. You have allowed us to come here to freely worship your name, to be in unity with one another, Lord. We thank you so much for that. We thank you for this church, the people of this church, and for being in this community, Lord. We ask, Lord, that you would help us to see where you are working in this community and to join you there. And Lord, we lift up to you, Clydette, just during this time as the surgery gets closer and scheduling and whatnot, Lord, just be with her and allow everything to go through smoothly. We lift up Gloria to you, Lord, and her family. She's been placed on hospice, and we just need peace and comfort to abound within that family, Lord. Lord, we pray for Emily, ask for healing upon her so that she can be up and running again, full tilt. We lift up, Lord, the teacher shortage to you. We have so many precious kids at these schools, Lord, and they need teachers. And we ask, Lord, that you would just bring those teachers here. Let them find the joy and love that this community has to offer. Lord, we lift up Eric Albright, Judy Daniel, Kathy Dixon-Born, Janice Brown, and Kenny Brown. Joe Bird, David Cooley, Betty Edwards, and Robin Estes. We lift up Patsy Flores, Ann Hand, Brenda Hand, Judy Henson, Carlson McLucky, Hunter Price, Nita Watson, and Nancy Wimberly. Lord, we also lift up to you all the unspoken prayers out there. You know what is on our hearts and on our minds, Lord, and we just pray, Lord, that your healing touch will come down upon all these people, Lord, and allow us to praise and worship your name and the strength and awesomeness that you provide, Lord. And now, Lord, we'd like to pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Praise team.
Good morning, everybody. If you grab your hymn books and turn to number 158, we're going to sing Come Christians Join to Sing. And after you do that, please stand.
Thank you.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Father, we ask that you bless these tithes and offerings. Allow them to multiply so that we can use them as good stewards in the work that you are doing in our community and abroad. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to give back to you what you have given to us. In your heavenly name, amen.
Thank you.
children here at Children's Church. Do you have your backpacks with you? Because we might have something for them underneath this very fancy, awesomely decorated mystery card. You have a secret pocket? I don't know if this will fit in that secret pocket. You can come on now. All right, so do you guys know what a blessing of the backpacks is? Well, that's what a backpack is for. But it's also a time where the church can give little things that you might need in your backpack to help you at school. Sometimes it's a reminder of a verse or a scripture. Maybe a little button that reminds you of who Jesus is. Or maybe just something fun like a piece of candy to wake you up. Okay? All sorts of things. But before we pass those out, we want to pray for you all to have a good school year. Okay? And if there's middle schoolers or high schoolers, we're going to need you guys next. Yes.
All right.
Yeah? Well, you just get to be up here for both then. All right? So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that this school year you watch over these precious children. Allow them to have open minds, willing to learn. Keep them safe, Lord. Protect them each and every day. Allow them to be surrounded by Christian friends that build each other up and encourage one another throughout the day, Lord. Give them strength to resist temptations and the energy to praise your holy name when called. We thank you so much for these children. In your name we pray. Amen. Now, Susan, can we get a hand with passing some of this stuff out? I'm going to let Miss Susan. So we have some pre-K and K bags. We have some elementary and middle school bags. So there's pre-K, there's elementary school. We got Reagan in middle school.
I'm in second grade.
Yeah, all right, so I'm going to grab a couple bags too. So we got second grade. Okay, what grade are you going into? There you go. And you're third grade, fourth grade too, yeah? Now, where's our high schoolers and middle schoolers?
Thank you.
Okay. We'll be middle school now, right? Okay. Middle school. And high school. Middle school. Any others of our students here? All right. Now, do we have any teachers here or people that work in the school system? Like maybe paras or custodial staff or anything like that? Or homeschool teachers? Yeah, that counts too. You teach. So. Because there's some stuff up here, because we're going to pray for all of y'all. That's a lot. That's a lot, huh?
A lot.
So, and just because I like to be color-coded so I can keep everything straight, the one male, you're blue. Yeah. Let's see. Oh, yeah, I know. Everybody high school students, our middle school students, who are going to make sure that all these littler ones are done mentored and proper, right? You know, you're going to take care of them if you see them on a bus or anything like that. And the high schoolers are going to take it and keep an eye out for the middle schoolers. And then who keeps an eye out for the high schoolers?
The teachers.
The teachers do? Okay. So, all right. But we all work together as a community, right?
Those high schoolers can be tough.
The high schoolers can be tough? That's very true. Let us pray.
Yeah, I know teenagers.
Okay, you ready to pray?
That's what my mom tells me about.
Heavenly Father, we have so many precious children. We have young adults. We have kids that have grown up in this church that are moving on to middle school, some into high school, and some high schoolers getting ready to start looking at colleges, Lord. And we lift up all of them to you. And we ask that you just shower down blessings upon them, Lord. Help them to stay strong in the faith that this church has taught them, Lord. To keep your scripture close at heart. And Lord, we pray for all the teachers and the faculty out there. It is getting harder and harder to be a teacher and to be in the school systems, Lord. And we just pray that you give them strength. Encourage them, Lord. Give them the grace and mercy that they need, and the discernment to know the truth and to see the students that are struggling and to be able to lift them up. Lord, bless all those that work for the school in whatever position they work in. Let them live for you each and every day in our work. In your heavenly name we pray this. Amen.
Mike, can we get a group picture?
Can we get a group picture? Sure. I will move my well-decorated cart all the way.
Don't stay there.
Why can't I just
Can you?
Get up there.
Okay. I'm good enough.
I'm going to be down here with a little kid. Because I like that. All right. You guys, gather. You guys ready?
Y'all like each other a little bit better. Get closer.
Yay!
I'm waiting for it to get settled.
Hey, Capri.
Capri! All right, everybody, look at me. One, two.
Swiss cheese.
All schools are awesome.
Yay!
There we go.
All right, y'all. Get ready for children's church. And Susan's bringing it.
Thank you.
be beautiful. Absolutely. This mic is giving me issues. We'll see if it stays on my ear. Hey, the sermon, Pleasing Prayers and Loving Confidence. Now, when Steve read from 1 Kings, Solomon had asked God for understanding, an understanding mind, the ability to discern good from evil. And in verses 10 and 11, listen to what it says. It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. And God said to him, because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right. See, Solomon, he was asking God for something for himself, but it wasn't to benefit himself. It was solely for the purpose of helping those he was appointed over. He was appointed to lead God's people. He was already in that position, but he knew he could not do it on his own. He needed God's help. And he went to God and asked him for this. And it says that God was pleased with this prayer. Throughout the Bible, we see example after example of God blessing people not so that they can acquire wealth or power themselves, but blessing them with skills and abilities that will be a blessing to others. We start seeing in this when we pray, it is not to pray for selfish desires, but to pray selflessly so that we may be a blessing to someone else. And then in Romans 8, Paul speaks some more about prayer, some more ways that we need to think about it. In Romans 8, verses 26 to 28, and then again in 31 to 33, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to His purpose. And then moving on to verse 31. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also with Him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. In this passage, 1 Kings, we saw this selflessness in prayer that we need to have. And here in Romans, we're seeing a call to be open in prayer. We get a larger sense now of what type of prayers are pleasing to God. In verse 26, it speaks of the Spirit interceding for us, that when we can't find the words, the Spirit will intercede and speak for us. But in order for that to happen, we have to be open to the Spirit speaking to us. That in our time of prayer, we are to seek to be filled by the Spirit and not simply just spout off a list of requests or demands. We need to be open. And it's hard for us to do that today, isn't it? I think it's harder now than it used to be, because it seems like today all we do is sprint from this thing to this thing to this thing, and we're always going full tilt. But in prayer, that is not the time to be sprinting. That is the time for that leisurely stroll with God. It is the time to sit on the front porch in the rocking chair and let Him wash over you. We need to stop sprinting through our prayers and give God time to talk to our hearts, to actually stop and listen, to pause, to breathe as we pray. And then hear what He has put on our hearts and lift that up to God. We also have to be loving in our prayers. Verse 28 says, "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to His purpose." What does it mean to love God? When we love someone, how do we speak to them? When we love someone, how do we listen to them? What is the evidence that we love someone? It's hard to describe how we speak to someone we love. It's tough to do that. But the Bible does a pretty good job using this idea of marriage. And so I want to use that same idea. If we think back, some of us, that wouldn't be too long, others who maybe have been married recently for 50 plus years, it may be harder to think back to that day when you said, "This is the one that I want to marry." But when we think back to those days, how much did we yearn to be with that person? How much of our heart wanted to be with that person day in and day out? How much of us wanted to look deeply into that person's eyes as we spoke to them about our day? How do we listen to those future spouses of ours when they would tell us about their day? Maybe we held them close as they spoke. Maybe we reclined against them as they talked to us. Maybe we just held their hands. But through it all, there was this deep craving to be connected in that conversation, to have our focus completely on them. And how did those future spouses know that we love them? How did our family and friends know that we were so deeply in love? Because of what we did, right? We talked to our friends about how much we love our spouse. We talked to our family about it. We did things for that future spouse. Maybe put gas in their car. Maybe swing by and help out with some yard work. We did all sorts of things to show our love. But is it any different with God? Do we crave to be connected to God the way we crave to be connected to our spouse? Do we yearn to be with them and to see them? Do we have that same yearning for God? When I talk about love and loving God, marriage holds steady in this analogy, because sometimes in marriage, we slip into a routine, don't we? We say I love you as we go out the door or when we hang up the phone. And after 10 years of saying it, or 20, or 30, or more, are we pausing to think about what that phrase means? It happens the same in church. We get into a routine of loving God. We show up on Sundays, we sit in the same pew, we sing the same songs, we repeat the same liturgies. But do we pause in that to see what that love really is about? What that love of God truly means each time we shut our eyes and say the Lord's Prayer? Are we trying to connect to God like that? Or has it become routine and habitual without the emotion? You see, in our prayer life, to have loving prayer time with God, we have to stay in love with God. Not just saying it, but feeling it in our hearts and having it in our minds, living it in our actions. We have to yearn to be with Him, to live the life that He desires for us. Our prayer life needs to reflect that. When we go to Him on bended knee or sitting at the kitchen table, it doesn't matter where, but we have to remember that love. And then we talk to Him about how we can help others. We lift others up to Him, and we seek to do His will. That is what loving prayer is about. And the final area, and no, it's not the end of the sermon, but the final area is His confidence in prayer. In verse 31 through 33, it says, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also with Him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies." We have confidence because of this passage. We pray with confidence because we know how much God loves us. We know it. We have read the stories. We know the scriptures of what He has given, how He has blessed, what miracles He has performed. We pray with confidence because we are children of the King. We have been adopted into His royal family when we chose to believe. So we have confidence. We pray with confidence because we know that there is only one person who can ever judge us, whose judgment is the only one that matters. It's not what our neighbors say about us or our friends. It is only God that we have to worry about. We pray with confidence because God's only Son, who was and will and was and is without blame, died for us, for me, and for you. We pray with confidence because He is our Messiah, our Savior. We have committed ourselves to Him even with our daily faults and shortcomings. And he has accepted us and called us his own. And we can pray with confidence because we know that God hears our prayers. Because we have seen the answered prayers. We have read about answered prayers. We have heard stories on the news of miracles when people pray. And even when doubts fly through our mind when we're praying, because the devil loves to plant that seed of doubt and fear. But if we think about what Mark wrote about in chapter 9, where this man came up to Jesus, his son afflicted with a demon that would cause the child to throw himself into the family fire as they were cooking dinner. And he asked Jesus if he could heal him. Jesus, it's like, if? Do you not know who I am? And the man asked him, help me in my unbelief. So even with the doubts, even as they raced through this man's mind, as he's praying for his son to be healed, Jesus still healed that boy. Even with the father's doubts, Jesus strengthened him and saw the concern. We are confident in our prayers because even when we doubt, Jesus still answers our prayers. Our selflessness in prayer, our openness in prayer, our love in prayer, all builds to the confidence we have in our prayers. We know this because we see it in our own lives, don't we? How happy are we as parents when we see our child do something unselfish to help someone else? When we see our child love someone who needed love. When we see our child step forward on that stage to maybe give their first presentation and they have confidence because they're looking out and they see you in the audience. What does that do to our hearts when we see our children do that? So how much more does it do to God's heart when he sees us, his children, stepping forward in confidence and doing what he has called us to do, which is to help one another, to love one another, to forgive one another? It's amazing, isn't it? This idea that the Bible puts down again and again, comparing marriage to the relationship that we have with God, to the relationship we have with Jesus. We can understand a little bit about God's great love for us because he has given us a glimpse when we look at our spouse of what love is. A glimpse when we look at our children and know what love is. And yet God's love is so much deeper, we still can't fathom the whole thing. It is absolutely stunning what God has done for us. And when we pray, we have to be in love like that, to pray with confidence like that. We have to pray. We are the children of God. a family, brothers and sisters in Christ, unified. We come together to worship, and we come together to pray for one another, to lift each other up, to serve each other with our hands. God uses all of us so that we may transform the world for Him. And that, my friends, is what this is all about. We have a loving and just God. And in that sweet, sweet hour of prayer, He moves me from this world into His presence. We are surrounded by Him when we pray. He comforts me in seasons of distress and grief. He strengthens and encourages me when it's time to resist a temptation. How I love that sweet hour of prayer. And as you may have guessed, that is our closing hymn. Page 496. As you sing this song in a prayerful mood, praising and worshiping Him, give to Him all that weighs you down. Turn to Him and seek Him. And let the Spirit guide you. The altar is open. It is time to pray and rejoice in our Heavenly Father. Praise Him.
Please stand and let's sing together, Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Us and encourage us as we seek to grow your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.